and happy birthday, Wellington. So one of the most famous students of Wellington told me, oh, you know, the day you speak is the day of his actual birthday. So you should bring a candle. So I tried to bring a candle. But then he embarrassed me because I almost fell. He told me, you have to put the candle on a pie. So really, but I got a little idea. So here is a candle on the pie. Happy birthday. I'm a joker. I'm a smoker. OK, so that's back to let's be serious a few minutes. So as I said, that's written, sorry. This is work I did with Zeze, and part of it we did also with Paolo Wilton. Okay, so yeah, you see, I should. And I'm going to speak about other things. So the topological entropy is rather dear to my heart because, you know, I ended up working for years in the lab same lab as Roy Adler, who died a few months ago, unfortunately, and with whom I worked a lot recently. But when we did the universality of period doubling with Pierre, we started from a point of view which was quite different from the one Mitch used. He observed that the period doubling was done at some rate and started from there. We started from the fact that there is something which resembles a Cantor set if you look at high iterate. And this reminded us, since there was a transition between simple behavior on one side and more possibility of more complicated behavior on the other side, this reminded us immediately the context of statistical mechanics and transition, magnetization to non-magnetization when you hit some pieces of metal. So everything was in place, but we needed something which would be like, so we had the equivalent of and it's, you can see it, in fact. You know, that's what is manifested by this Cantor set. There is, and the bifurcation on both sides. One of the things which count in statistical mechanics is that the correlation length diverges when you approach to the critical point from above or from below. And here, the correlation length, on one side, is the period of the orbits. The maximal the period of the stable orbits. On the other side is the period of the chaotic orbits, the little windows which circulate. And this is what's important for us because the simplest model of interval map you can think about is the tent map, and there is no period doubling. At most, you get one if you break the symmetry. But on the other end, on the other side, you do have the noisy period doubling. So we could use the tent map as an exact model, but we were still missing something, which was the equivalent of the magnetization. What is the quantity which was going like that? And somebody told us, you know, there is a person in Marseille who knows something which is called topological entropy. Nobody knew about topological entropy in Nice, so we ended up learning what it was. It was really a long time ago, you know. And we looked at it and we proved that in the tent map, at least, the topological entropy was behaving with the critical behavior coming from the unstable eigenvalues that everybody has been talking about before. We didn't have the contraction, but we had the behavior there. From there on, we began to promote the idea that maybe the right way to speak about transition to chaos would be transition to positive topological entropy. Because there was something which was more already popular, in particular in the Russian in the Russian literature, where they were doing lots of things in integrable system, sorry, in Hamiltonian system and the application to plasmas and stuff like that, which was the Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy. But in terms of transition to chaos, it's not good because it's positive out of a Cantor set, on a Cantor set, and you have all these holes in between. So it's not a good thing which resembles the magnetization. Well, the topological entropy has really the right behavior of something which grows like this with a critical exponent where it stops to be zero. So that's the context. Once you have if you accept that topological entropy is a good potential tool, then you begin to realize that at that time it was not mature, that because it's only much later that one had conditions for semi-continuity in the C1 plus epsilon case given by Katok, or lower for C0 only for interval maps. And we had to wait for the work of Yomdin to have continuity in the C-infinity case. But eventually, these results appeared, so this confirms that perhaps this is a good tool. And then you have this problem of trying to understand, the transition from zero to positive entropy. So we'll see that there are some hurdles. But I'm going to try to go first to the places where there is no more not so much hurdle, but rather things which might be interesting. So like many people, we rediscovered independently things which were reminiscent of the work of Cartwright, Littlewood, and Levinson, which led to the picture of Smail, which means things which were like circle maps, but which were rather to circle maps what Enon mapping was to the interval map. So maps from embedding from the annulus to itself. And we realized that this would be an interesting story because, and that, like in the circle, which we did not yet analyze at that time. I mean, none of us was yet mathematician. In fact, only one became, partly. But we understood, you know, as physicists, that there was a big difference between the circle and the interval. That's an interval, in order to have recurrence, you need to fold. And that's the only way you can create complicated behavior, or even recurrent behavior, even non-complicated. While on the circle, you have two ways to come back, which compete with each other. One is the same folding as you have in the interval, but you have also the simple fact that you are on the circle. So, and we were, of course, only looking at degree one, first of all, because higher degree, there is no problem of transition to chaos because it's always chaotic, even at least with topological entropy. And furthermore, what's interesting is, for physicists, is mostly the case when you start from a hop bifurcation, you create a periodic orbit for a flow, and then you begin to see this periodic orbit behave in a funny way, become fractal, coming close to certain points. So for us, circle map always meant degree one, and in this talk it will always be degree one, okay? So what do you do with that? So you can try to solve, but before I got engaged in trying to understand the transition to chaos for circle maps. During my thesis, I studied the general problem of flows in R3 with homoclinic or heteroclinic behavior between critical points, and the way different type of symmetry would generate different type of attractor. So that's when we began to play with the Shinnikov theorem that Newhouse was talking about. I mean, I gave a proof. But much later, our point was at that time was to prove empirically that if you have a situation like this can explain many forms of chaos that one encounter in systems which were studied by at that time. But what the big surprise was in the classification, it became natural to say, okay, what happens if I have the same symmetry as the Lorentz system, which is a symmetry around an axis? And instead of having the leading eigenvalue contracting, the expansion stronger than the contraction, have the contrary. So here. Where is it? Here. Oh, Baba. Too fast. I don't have a good finger. So here is you could say that this is the same manifold from Lorentz. It is. The only difference is that at the critical point here, or somewhere here, that's the two-dimensional stuff, the way with the branched manifold, the way a la Williams. This is a piece, a forward invariant piece, which appears. So it's really like Lorentz, but with the expanding eigenvalue weak, relatively weak. And I tried weeks and weeks and months, maybe, to find something like that in the Lorentz equation. I would be tempted to conjecture that you cannot find it there. But I broke a fit, and this allowed me to get this equation. The equation, but something went wrong here. Anyway, there should be an equation here which has disappeared. Anyway, it's in the paper. And I wrote an equation which is cubic instead of being quadratic. And the relation with breaking a foot is very simple. I could not move, so Coulet and one of his friends brought me the computer we were using in the lab. And since I was in pain, I could not sleep, so I was in front of the computer 22 hours a day, and I ended up building the right equation. You know, but it was not just chance. It was, you know, I moved. Anyway, I got it, and these are actual, in the top here, these are actual things that you get from there, and it resembles even more the geometric Lorentz attractor of Buchenheimer, Williams, and so on than the original Lorentz. But we only looked at the symmetric case. In the symmetric case, you are essentially in the same case as for symmetric endomorphism of the interval. So not quite fascinating from the point of view of topological entropy. So with that, I let that aside and went back to the other problem, the circle maps. So I proposed to Robert Mackay to look with me at the problem of the transition to chaos for circle maps, which we had identified before, as I told you, as interesting because there is this competition. And my idea at that time was that if you look at the frequency locking region if you take the harmonic sequence going to the rotation number 0 over 1, the tips here of the harmonic sequence, so 1/2, 1/3, 1/4, and so on, would go to 0 when you approach. And this was really the idea we had in mind, and this was, you know, essential for us in some sense. But as I always said, it's not necessary to have the good conjecture. It's enough to have a conjecture which is interesting. At the end, you can prove the contrary. Okay. But anyway, with this picture in mind, we put together the tools to understand that. And there, at the same time, I was working also with Jean-Marc and Chancinier, and we made some progress on the concept of rotation interval. We had new tools to study that. So everybody understands what is a rotation number. Perhaps you don't all know what is a rotation interval, although it appeared already in the conference. But it's a set of rotation numbers of all the points of the on the circle. Another way to say that is that you look at the graph of a map of a degree one map, and you look at the monotone upper bound and the monotone lower bound, the monotone upper bound being monotone as a rotation number, the monotone lower bound being also monotone as another rotation number, and this interval between these two rotation numbers is the rotation interval of the endomorphism. In fact, the concept was created probably here anyway by Floris Takens, according to Newhouse. It appeared in a paper treating lots of things about bifurcation by Newhouse, Jaco, and Takens. I think both Jaco and Newhouse tell me that for that part, it was really what was pushed by Floris. Anyway, so with this tool at hand, we isolated this concept of while you have the Arnold tongs well known under the critical line, which correspond to the present where you have a given rotation number, which is unique. Above it, since you may have a rotation interval, you need another concept. So you can still look at where the rotation number, the rotation interval is reduced to the point, and then you have one of these locking region, like, let me draw in. Here is one, half of one. Another one would be here. That's where you have a single rotation number. And then in the rest, you have a rotation interval. But still, the locking region for a given rational opens like this. And above, you still have the property that the rotation numbers that you have in the core here belongs to the rotation interval. So you have two locus. The locus where the rotation interval is reduced to a single number, and the region in parameter space, for instance, or you can consider it also in the space of all maps, where the given number is part of the rotation interval. So, and one is obviously contained in the other. So with that at hand, and standard, rather standard at that time type of assumption on the map, in particular, it had to be negative Schwarzian derivative above the critical line, we could understand the structure of the map and realize that when you have a map which is in one of these regions, then this means that it exchanges interval in which the map is, you know, it can be like this, or like that, meaning that this line here is where the critical point here is mapped to one of the unstable cycle with a good rotation number. And at that time, to model what's going on here, we did not have all the tools which was have been developed by Aaron Sebastian, by himself and others. So we could not seriously, I mean, we could do numerics, but we could not do serious mathematical studies on transcendental functions. So we modeled what was going on inside there by saying, oh, it's bimodal, so the good model for that is cubic polynomials, which are of the type growing, decreasing, growing. Or increasing, decreasing, increasing. Okay, so that puts the things in place. So we had a description of the theory of the boundary of chaos and the structure. And then a bit later, and in particular with Jean-Marc, I mean the people who are here. So I started to look at the asymmetric case. This is now the asymmetric case of what I showed before with all this picture, the Lorentz-like map with the contraction, but no, without symmetry. So I began that November 82, one month before my daughter got born in Minneapolis. And she was not born in Minneapolis. I was in Minneapolis. And a few years after, with a considerable help, I mean, you have good, strong people on the left here, we got this picture. But we were faced with the same type of problems that Marco and Wellington were faced with. We realized that the monotony along one parameter was easy, but the monotony on the other side was not easy, which means that once you have this type of tongs that you might remember you saw also in the endomorphism of the circle case, you might have the fact that these lines which bound that cross again. So in the circle case with Adam Epstein and Linda Keane, I could prove eventually, after doing it for myself and with the big help of Marco for piecewise affine map, we could prove that for, say, the sine family, we could not have things like that. So, but it's still unknown, as far as I know, for the Lorentz, contracting Lorentz. What I mean is that I'm asking here mostly Wellington and Marco. If you take one of these bubbles where the rotation number is unique, you don't know if there is not a single another one later. Yeah, this is still unknown, I think. But if you speak about transition, so with these two things at hand, the one I presented before, the endomorphism, and here you have a kind of a general question which appears, what can you say about the boundary of chaos or of circular chaos? So what do I call circular chaos? It's an elementary form of chaos where you have two orbits which turn at different speed. So if you have a continuous map, or if you have only the type of discontinuities that you can find in the Lorentz map, what you can do is you take these two points which turn at different speed, and you look at the little interval in between, and you wait, and that covers the circle many times, and then this means this forms of horseshoe. So that's a trivial way to do chaos in this type, in both type of system. But you can also find chaos inside. For other reasons, the interval map way, and in particular, if you have a cubic type map which is fully covering, you expect that if this happens for rotation number p over q, you will have rotation topological entropy log of 3 divided by q. Yeah, so you have other ways to create chaos. So you need to put that all together. So by here, I should say that. For circle maps, what we did was done also independently. I don't remember the exact date. Phil Boylan might have been a bit before us. He did not look exactly as much as we did, but we were two and he was alone. And he was probably first. Okay. Phil is a great guy anyway. So you have this story of trying to understand what's going on here. And then it's easy to see that if you go out this way, even if you have no chaos here, you arbitrarily close, you will find positive topological entropy, because you have some of the things of these tips at least which will be there accumulating here. So now, while I was in Weitzmann, Bohr, from the same family who got all these Nobel Prizes, and Gunnar Atné, who was a student or at least a postdoc anyway of Feigenbaum, working together, realized that these tongues were not going to zero. So another visitor of the guy I was visiting, a guy named Barry Friedman, saw this paper. And I was lecturing, I was giving a course on dynamical system at the Weizmann Institute, and he said, oh, I think you are going to be interested in this paper. And the next morning, I came back with a statement and a proof, the statement being that the boundaries of rotational chaos and of topological chaos are not locally connected for endomorphism of a circle of this type. So it's a very strong result, and as I hope I will be able to convince partly, it's very, very simple. It's probably one of the best ratio interest of the statement divided by difficulty of the proof that I can think about. I mean, not in number theory, I mean in this context. This thing is bizarre. You cannot trust machines. Okay. So, having proved that, and I will not tell you the proof because I'm going to tell you two proofs at once for the same price. Then we went to degree one, remained to prove the same, to ask the question, is it the same thing or is it different for Lorentz maps? And for years, I could not move. And then I was encouraged by first Paolo and Wilton, and during a carnival we outlined the proof, and I finished that last year with Zezé, and we have now a proof that for good class of maps of the Lorentz contractive Lorentz type, the boundary of positive entropy of the boundary of zero entropy and of absence of rotational chaos are both non-locally connected. In fact, let's go back one thing. You see this on top, that's a typical comb, because what we have is a comb effect. Like in most cases when you have something which is not locally connected. But this one is easy to, first of all, we know it's here, and secondly, it's easy to prove. And I sent that, I did that about the same time when Milnor discovered that in the cubic locus, there is also something which is not locally connected. So that was my entrance key to Jack. Okay, so I'm going to use the notes that they sent me. That's enough, because what's happening here is that you can, time about maybe to begin to behave in a civilized way, which means a piece of chalk. I wanted to give a chalk talk, but then I say, oh, these are nice pictures. And then there are so many nice pictures that there is no more room for the rest. So there are two things that one can look at once. One is the Lorentz case. And you have this discontinuity here. And you will understand better what this is, because the circle case remains a bit simpler in some sense. You have something like that. And here you have several points. This is what one calls usually C. This is K. I mean, if you call K C and say key, you can also do it, but we cannot talk to each other. This is K minus, the point which has the same value as K. Image as K, and of course, if there is a K minus, why shouldn't there be a C plus? Okay, and here, important thing, somewhere here, you have a diagonal, the first diagonal, you can. It's easy to realize, to convince yourself that each time you have, because we are looking at rotation number of the type 1 over n, you turn around, you know, this. This interval turns around and just come back. So which means that you have things like that, and at some point, these two points are going to be the boundary of a domain where the Q-citerate, if the rotation number is P over Q, will look something like that in this case. And something like that in the other case. You are just missing the middle branch in some sense. What you can see from there is that it is a macroscopic condition. What's important here is that this goes here. So what you need is that so this is C plus. So it's F of K is, it's equal to C plus. And you have, for the other side of the rotation number 0 over 1, you have the symmetric relation. But this is a macroscopic relation. You see that, you know, it doesn't make, this is the same for all the rotation number of the form 1 over n. And you don't see anything of the parametrization or of the rotation number appearing here. Okay? So now what you have to do that you can, if you have that, and at the same time you are close to the tongue corresponding to 0 over 1, so this is the tongue 0 over 1, and this is one of the harmonics, so let's say 1 over n, rotation number 1 over n. What you want to prove is that this goes here, contrary to our original conjecture, which is that this goes here when n goes to infinity. So these are two equations. So unfortunately, in this case, they are transcendental. So it's easy, a bit, especially for me. I mean, I don't like to solve too many transcendental equations in a given day. But you can check numerically that the solution, which correspond to be both on the boundary here and to have this condition, brings you a point which is way above. Okay, and also, if you want to be a bit more, if you forget about finding exact value and want only to prove the main statement, you can realize that if you would be close to the, too arbitrarily close to the critical line, you would have something like that, with this arbitrarily close to the slopes, an absolute value being arbitrarily close to zero in this whole stuff, and no way you can do it. So you can see that this type of analysis transports exactly here as well. The difference is that for reasonable parametrization of that, modulo the discussion with John the other day, where he was looking at geometric stuff. But if you are at only as I am here for the time being, interested in the topological aspect, a two-parameter family such that a minus, no, that's zero. Oops. So let me forget about that, in fact, because that's really perturbating when you think about this is the trace of the stable manifold of the origin in the flow. So this is now a minus x, a minus x to the alpha. And this is minus b plus x to the alpha. You can put coefficients here, but for topological part, it's not important. Okay? So if you have an equation like that, and in particular you can choose alpha square, so that now you have a nice algebraic equation, you can find, you can ask yourself, can you find that and be on the equivalent of that at the same time? So the lines are a bit different here, because what? Essentially what you have, if you have this bubble and something like that, then this thing will create close to P over Q something which is exactly like the big bubble and topologically. And this is a model which is completely renormalizable. It should have been normal that renormalization be invented in this context, because everything looks like little bubbles, big bubbles. And you know, some people like bubbles. I can only drink bubbles. So yeah, bubbles all over the place, and they resemble each other topologically. And then, if you choose alpha correctly, you have a minus correctly. To be simple, you get a minus x squared and minus b plus x squared. You can realize that if you want to realize this property, in fact, it's one of the equation over there, and you have two ways to finish that. Either you say, what's happening if I'm close to the critical line, you get a contradiction, or you can find exactly the point where you are, and you see that it is above the critical line. So, in some sense, at once, putting the things together, you can prove that you have non-local connectivity of the boundary of rotational chaos. What you need to prove for that is to prove that the first tip, assuming there are many, and we know that there are not many for the sign map, but it could be the case for Enon, for Lorentz. So you have to prove that this tip do that. But what about period doubling? What about chaos? Chaos, topological entropy. Boundary of topological entropy is more complicated because you need to show that it's lower. Yeah. So it's more difficult to deal with. And contrary to what was happening before, here you cannot say that it's just something related to that. You need also to understand what's going on here, because it could be the case that you accumulate so much growth along the orbit when you come close to the tangency that you can get a picture which is almost flat, but thanks to the rest, you get all the deformation that you want to be chaotic. But it's not the case because when you have something like that in a circle, for a circle map type of stuff, you can decompose the orbits in two parts. You fix a channel size, I mean, then the map will by deformation will come maybe closer. But there is this channel part here where the dynamics is simple, but you should put it closer, sorry. So that's the dynamics here. And you can choose a piece here. And you can check two things. First of all, out of there, the number of pieces of slope is bounded. And it's a small number. I mean, you can, you know, no problem with that. You might make a mistake by one, but it's nothing. And then inside here, what you realize is that the relationship between this slope, this size, and this size, or this size and this size, is just related to, is exactly controlled by the product of slopes. And since these two things are macroscopic but small but, you know, non-microscopic, then the ratio remains bounded. So which means that in the same spirit but in a more delicate way, if you have something flat, you cannot, because of the iteration, have something which where you have slope which are enough to get you chaos. And that's it. So at once here, you have the non-local connectivity of the two type of chaos for the two type of models. You have to pay attention that the models be not nasty. Like, for instance, you want, it's helpful to have negative Schwarzschild derivative. I'm not sure you need it, but I'm sure that, you know, Wellington and a few others in this room have fought a long time to eliminate this type of, to have it coming as a consequence of more natural conditions, should I say. Yeah. But besides that, it's all trivial for a result which is surprising when you think about it. But now, how much time do I have? Five? Six? Okay, seven then. So, one thing one could try to do is to ask whether or not at least this picture goes to higher dimension, but it has been done already. And in fact, the annulus version of that was done a long time ago by Aframovich and Chilnikov, and redone in the paper I mentioned before of Newhouse, Palis, and Takens. Okay, but you know it was Aframovich himself and a few others were thinking that none of the treatment was really good. But now, starting from all that, I think we have better tools than were available long ago. I mean, the subject has made so much progress. I think this here on the left here, the top thing, anyway, you cannot read it. And if you can read it, you should not tell me because otherwise I'm going to be upset. And not on purpose. I wanted it to be readable. I'm joking. But this is the beginning of the paper I was mentioning of Aframovich and Chilnikov. And there, no, yeah, or Gavrilov and Chilnikov, I don't remember. Anyway, Aframovich was also involved in, no, it's Aframovich and Chilnikov. So they introduced a new concept, which is, which has some antecedent, but they isolate the concept of attainable and non-attainable boundaries. So, example, boundary of the closure of the set of Morsmel. But for me, more interesting, boundary of zero entropy. So now the question is, what is an attainable piece of the boundary? This means that you start from the inside where the entropy is zero, and you can reach the boundary of zero entropy with a finite number of bifurcations. Non-attainable is that you need an infinite number of bifurcations in order to reach the stuff. So behind what I did with Robert Mackay, for instance, or which was done also by Phil Boylan, amounted to show that some piece of the boundary of topological chaos or circular chaos for circle maps were attainable. And there is something funny. It's precisely because of this mechanism which were involved here that we had the non-local connectivity of the boundaries. On the other hand, this one, yeah. On the other, no, let me go for, no, it's here, not here. Hop, no. Anyway, that, this machine is really bizarre, I will tell you. Me too, I know, but otherwise I would never be invited anywhere. So, anyway, so I wanted to tell that with Crovisier, I wanted to have a precise statement. But essentially, maps which are strongly dissipative, which means that the stable manifold go out to the boundary. You don't trap, so you have embeddings of the disk, and you don't want any stable manifold to be trapped into there. Okay? So, and you want area contraction. So if you have a map like this on the disk, which contract volumes, but, and have also this extra property, then what we can prove is that there is some R and a sequence 2R, 4R, 8R, 16R, 32R, 80, and so on. A cascade of period doubling starting from some period in order to be able to get out from the zero entropy region. So, but in this case, since you have under enough smoothness, you are in the realm of universality and of renormalization, and then you expect to be accumulated on the stable manifold of the fixed point of renormalization, the one you choose, and then this manifold is regular, so you have a kind of a duality. On the one hand, you have simplicity of the transition to chaos, but the price you pay is that the boundary itself is not locally connected. But on the other, for that happens if you look at diffeomorphism, or embedding, sorry, of a manifold in genus 1 or above, while if you look at the disk, then the transition to chaos itself is complicated because you are non-attainable typically, but the boundary itself doesn't have this type of defect. But unfortunately, I think this picture is not true. I mean, Sebastian and Brun, stop. You know whom I speak. I've proved that for modality high enough, then the boundary of chaos inside the equivalent of the tongues is also not locally connected. But there, since you are, after some iteration, you have an interval map, you cut the circle to intervals where the return maps are interval maps, then this means that you are in the realm of accumulation of period doubling. So accumulation of period doubling in complicated situation can also lead to funny aspects of the boundary of topological entropy. So I'm almost done. So this is about work that we did recently with Edson De Faria and Peter Hazard. And Peter Hazard and Edson, Peter Hazard. And I've repeated the name of the guy who needs the job. So Peter Hazard and other people did the following thing. First of all, a bit of background. Ito and later Bowen proved that if you have a C1 map, the strongest eigen, the biggest eigenvalue will give you up to log or exponential a bound on topological entropy. So as a consequence, if you take a smooth map, on a manifold, a smooth, a diffeomorphism on a manifold or a smooth endomorphism on the circle or the interval, then the topological entropy will be finite because of the finiteness, the compactness of the manifold. But now you can ask what above? So in fact, so Bowen did that after Ritto. A little bit after, three person whose name I would not try to pronounce, otherwise my joke would fall down and I could not finish the talk, proved that a nice result, that the same statement I made up for C1 map also true for Lipschitz map. But then, a few years later, a paper which was sometimes considered as trivial, and in fact it's not that trivial everywhere, a nice paper after all, to my surprise, because for I could have done that. No, this is a it's not a bit more subtle that it appears at very first reading. Yano proved that if you have a C0 endomorphism in dimension 1 or a C0 homeomorphism in higher dimensions, then the topological entropy is generically finite. Infinite, sorry. Infinite. So now what's going on in between? So between C0 and C1. The thing is that, of course, there are many passes between. So you can choose at least two passes, and that's what we have done so far, only two passes. One is to interpolate by looking at older maps. The other one is by looking one of these. Oh, Sobolev regularity. So Sobolev function have been pretty much studied, but Sobolev maps, we couldn't find much. But anyway, in both cases, what you find is that in the same way, I mean, assuming that at the same time you are in the closure of the Lipschitz maps, the topological entropy is generically infinite for those maps. Now, is the closure of the Lipschitz map important? We conjecture that not, because we have examples of maps which are not, I'm wrong. It's always, yeah? Our examples are always closed, no? The two counter examples. Two Lipschitz. And not necessarily. Okay, that's what I thought. So, in fact, it was not used. I mean, remember how it came. We did not use the proximity of Lipschitz at all. And it seems it's probably the condition on close to Lipschitz is a technical condition. So, so this means that, you know, even if you come very, very close to C0 by taking a Hölder map with a very small exponent, then you still have topological entropy. That's not the good point. Even if you come close, very close to Lipschitz by taking an Hölder exponent very close to 1, then you still have the, instead of being bounded, the entropy, instead of being bounded, is generically infinite. One of the tricks to get to this type of result, at least for the Sobolev case, is to verify that, of course, that you are in bare spaces, because you want not only to have results, but you want them to be meaningful. So to be generic, if you are not, if you don't have an intersection of open dens, it's not very interesting. So we are in the good case, so things are significant. Another thing we did related to all these things about topological entropy is linked to the fact that Mizurevich, the first one, I mean, the first paper was not optimal, but, you know, I talked a lot with him. In fact, in four dimensions already, you can find diffeomorphism such that you have the topological entropy can be discontinuous. So we studied an example with Lorenzo Diaz and Enrique Pujals, where we showed that if you take one of these families where you have a discontinuity of the entropy, if you take a nearby pass, then you restore the continuity. So we have this conjecture, which might be interesting to tackle, that even in dimension, even for diffeomorphism of dimension 3, the topological, the transition to positive topological entropy is generically continuous, at least if you, yeah. So I think I've largely abused of my time. So thank you all, and happy birthday to Wellington. But unfortunately, you are not 1 year old, so yeah, that's an exact representation. Oh shit, you know, that's not what I wanted to do. Yeah, now you are going to count one, two, three, and when I arrive at three, you have to blow. So let's try. One, two, three. Yeah, it was, that's a bit more. One, two, that's done. So congratulations.